Well, I'm very grateful to start the day speaking here at the Hub to recognize its great success with 300 people working from here after only 2 years of existence, and to say that what you do here and what we are talking about today is about the future. As we emerge from recession, we do face fundamental questions about the kind of Britain we want to build for the future and about who will lead us there. The choices are about who's best for jobs, who's best for industry, who's best for the NHS, schools and public services. The decisions are about the changes we must make now that will lead us to a better tomorrow. And we need to ask, where's the plan not just to secure recovery, but to go for growth? The plan that will mean not just jobs for us today, but jobs for our children tomorrow. The plan that will see British business not just succeeding in the global marketplace of this generation, but leading in the global industries of the next. Now, this week's budget will set out the next stage of our plan to go for growth. It's built on two essential pillars. First, given the fragility of the economy, both here and across the world, and the continuing weakness of the global financial system, the essential requirement today, I believe, is to do everything possible to nurture and secure the recovery and put Britain back on a solid course for strong and balanced growth with the jobs that come from that. Second, once that recovery is assured, and the private sector is once again strong enough to drive the upturn without exceptional support from the government, we must carefully but decisively bring public borrowing back down fairly and without damaging frontline public services. Our strategy for growth is therefore not at the expense of the tough deficit reduction plan we have set out. Rather, it is absolutely central to it because it is growth that creates jobs, stimulates demand, and brings in revenue. Now, we know that the strong and balanced growth that we need will not materialize if we simply do nothing and stand back and leave it all to unbridled market forces. If we have learned one thing from the global recession of the last 2 years, it's that unfettered and unregulated markets cannot by themselves be relied upon to deliver a fair future for all of our citizens. So instead of a gamble on crude laissez-faire economics, we need a new industrial strategy for this country founded on an open partnership of business, individuals and government, doing all we can to support enterprise as the engine of economic growth and unleashing the great entrepreneurial, innovative and dynamic talents we see here and we have in Britain. Encouraging those sectors in which Britain has or can build a global advantage so Britain can truly lead the world. And it means, where necessary, investing now to provide the conditions in which private enterprise in these sectors can thrive in the future. Sectors such as advanced manufacturing, clean energy, high-speed rail, pharmaceuticals, science and research, and of course the digital industries on which I want to focus my remarks this morning. I want us to consider today the Britain of 2020, the Britain we can create at the leading edge of these knowledge-based industries, but also a Britain which leads the world as a result of that in open, personal, interactive public services and leads in the new politics. I want to make a radical set of proposals which include transfers and shifts in existing spending, including being prepared to cancel current projects, and which together with more detailed plans set out by the Chancellor in the budget on Wednesday will help us to save billions of pounds a year in public sector costs in the next few years. I want Britain to be the world leader in the digital economy, which will create over a quarter of a million skilled jobs, the world leader in public service delivery, where we can give the greatest possible voice and choice to citizens, parents, patients, and consumers, and the world leader in the new politics, where that voice for feedback and for deliberative decision-making can transform the way we make local and national policies and decisions. Now, underpinning the digital transformation that we are likely to see over the coming decade is the creation of the next generation of the web, what is often called the semantic web, or the web of linked data. The next generation web is a simple concept, but I believe it has the potential to be just as revolutionary, just as disruptive to existing business and organizational models as the web was itself, moving us from a web of managing documents and files to the web of managing data and information, and thus opening up the possibility of bypassing current digital bottlenecks and getting direct answers to direct requests for data. It will change fundamentally the way we conduct business, with new enterprises bypassing traditional media communications and governmental organizations. New enterprises spun off from the new data, information, and knowledge itself that will flow more freely. And in both the content and delivery of public services, the next stage of the web will transform the ability of citizens to tailor the services they need to their requirements, to feedback constantly on their success or failure, to interact with the professionals who deliver them, and to put the citizen, not the public servant, in control. And today I want to announce the first funding for the next stage of this research. £30 million to support the creation of a new institute, the Institute of Web Science, based here in Britain, working with government and British business to realise the social and economic benefit of advances in the web. It will assemble the best of world scientists and researchers. It will be headed by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the British inventor of the World Wide Web, and the leading web science expert, Professor Nigel Shadbolt. This will help place the UK at the cutting edge of research on the semantic web and other emerging web and internet technologies. It will ensure that government is taking the right funding decisions to position the UK as a world leader. And we will invite universities and private sector web developers and companies to join this collaborative project. So building on this next generation web and the radical opening up of information and data, and therefore more power in people's hands, the steps towards achieving this ambition to become the leader in the next stage of the digital revolution are threefold. First, to digitalize, to make Britain the leading superfast broadband digital power, creating 100% access to every home. Secondly, to personalize, seizing the opportunities for voice and choice in our public services by opening up data and using the power of digital technology to transform the way citizens interact with government. And third, to economize. In the pre-budget report, we set out our determination to find £11 billion of savings by driving up operational efficiency, much of it enabled by the increased transparency and reduced costs made available by new technology. On Wednesday, the Chancellor will set out more detailed plans for delivering these savings, totaling over £20 billion. But over the period ahead, I want to go much further in harnessing the power of technology to refashion the structures and workings of government. I want to deliver efficiencies not simply in the back offices and back rooms, but also looking at how the new technology can open the door to a reinvention of the core policy-making processes and towards a renewal of politics itself. And let me therefore address each of these stages in more detail. Britain is uniquely equipped to lead the digital age. We are already an international hub for creativity and commerce. We have the most lucrative e-commerce market in Europe. More than a quarter of our jobs, 7 million, are already in information, communications, and technology-related roles. And that's a higher proportion than in France, Germany, or even in America. This country has always been at its best when it has led the world in its pursuit of creativity and innovation, and in the promotion of fairness and liberty as we do so. And in so many ways, these issues and causes have come together in the extraordinary development of the World Wide Web. It's already creating formidable new businesses and transforming the way existing businesses operate. From online shopping and banking to checking train times or booking flights, from catching up with the news to staying in touch with our family and friends, the web has already profoundly changed the way many of us go about our daily lives. And it's not just about convenience, it's about quality of life too. The other day I heard how one of Britain's leading musicians who spends most of his time abroad reads his young son a bedtime story from thousands of miles away using Skype. Millions of us now can spend more time with our families because technology allows people to work more easily from home. And although hard to imagine, the revolution we have witnessed so far is only just beginning. The next stage will be radical expansion and enhancement of two-way communication between service providers and homes that new superfast broadband is beginning to make possible. The Google Smart Meters program delivers real-time information of home energy use to mobiles and office desktops. It helps people to manage energy consumption when they are out and so save money. And it could soon be commonplace for children to continue learning together after the school bell has rung by studying in virtual classrooms, and for doctors to hold video consultations from the surgeries with patients at home to diagnose and in some cases even treat them. The internet revolution is quite literally creating a different world. But just imagine if you weren't part of that world. Imagine if you had never accessed the internet. Imagine if you had no access to the best deals on the virtual high street that you can save on average £560 a year by shopping and paying bills online. Well, that is reality still for around 1 in 5 adults in the UK. 21% of UK adults have never accessed the internet. A fifth trapped in a second tier of citizenship, denied what increasingly I think of as a fundamental freedom in the modern world, to be part of the internet and technology revolution. It's unfair, it's economically inefficient, it's wholly unacceptable. Consider the advent of electricity. How acceptable would it have been to say that only some people should have access to electricity? Superfast broadband is the electricity of the digital age, and I believe it must be for all and not just for some. Now, we have already decided to commit public funding to ensure existing broadband reaches nearly every household in Britain by 2012. Now, governments must decide what action they will take to bring about access to the next generation of superfast broadband, simultaneously ensuring the highest quality content is available online and available also to all. The choice with broadband infrastructure is clear. We can allow unbridled market forces to provide a solution on its own terms and according to its own timetable, as others would do. The result would be superfast broadband coverage determined not even by need or social justice or by the national interest, but by profitability alone. This would open a lasting, pervasive, and damaging new digital divide. It would allow the country to become split between a fast track and a slow track to the future, between those fortunate enough to live in densely populated areas and not. But to concede a willingness to have superfast broadband reserved for some rather than all also betrays a total failure to grasp the scale of the educational, the economic, and the social opportunities that it brings. Because the truth is that a government that is prepared to allow a digital divide to grow would be one that creates a deeper and more pernicious divide than simply one of accessing email or online shopping services. Faster broadband speeds will bring new, cheaper, more personalized, and more effective public services also to people. It will bring, of course, games and entertainment options with new levels of sophistication. It will also make accessing goods and services immeasurably easier. And it will enrich our democracy by giving all people new ways of communicating, complaining, and challenging vested interests. In short, the world available to those with superfast broadband will be unimaginably richer than to those without. So one vision for digital Britain would create two nations, one digitally privileged, one digitally deprived, and this will mean a massive penalty in economic development to those who are denied access because of failure of government to rise to the challenge where markets may fail. The alternative is our vision, ensuring, not simply hoping for, universal coverage. We say that Britain's digital future must be a future for all and not just for some. If every household is to benefit, then it is fair that every household contribute to meeting this goal. And that is why we have chosen to raise a small levy on each household's phone line, 50 pence per month, about the price of a pint of milk, to help fund a partnership with the private sector, 50 pence a month for a super fast broadband network right across Britain. Building a universal fast speed digital infrastructure is necessary but not sufficient. High quality content, whether it is news, entertainment, games, networking sites, or information services, they rely on maintaining the conditions for innovation and competition online. So in addition to the measures in our digital economy bill, I say clearly today, we will support the independence of Ofcom to ensure creativity, diversity, and high standards. And we will retain the BBC license fee to ensure a strong, independent BBC remains at the forefront of providing world-class quality content across different media. So we are investing now in bringing superfast broadband and new technology to all. We're creating the right environment for innovation and competition in the digital sector. We are leading the next generation of the web and internet by our investment. But we must now also use this technology to open up data with the aim of providing every citizen in Britain with true ownership and accountability over the services they demand from government. And in doing so, we can put in place the best, most personalized, but universally accessible digital public services in the world. And we can harness the power of technology to economize, shaking up Whitehall and making us the most efficient, open, and responsive government in the world. Now, building on the outstanding work that Sir Tim Berners-Lee and Nigel Shadbolt, who have been leading on making public data public, I can announce that we are determined to go further in breaking down the walled garden of government, using technology and information to provide greater transparency on the workings of Whitehall and give everyone more say over the services they receive. In January, we launched data.gov.uk. Now, that's a single, easy-to-use website to access public data. Even in the short space of time since then, the interest this initiative has attracted globally has been incredibly striking. The site has already more than 3,000 data sets available. More are being added all the time. In the past months, the Office for National Statistics has opened up access for web developers to over 2 billion data items, right down to local neighborhoods levels. The Department for Transport and the transport industry are today making available the core reference data sets that can contain the precise names and coordinates of all 350,000 bus stops, railway stations, and airports in Britain. Public transport timetables and real-time time-running information is currently owned by the operating companies, but we will work to free it up, and from today we will make it a condition of future franchises that this data will be made freely available. Following the strong support in our recent consultation, I can confirm that from 1st April, we're making the substantial package of information held by Ordnance Survey freely available to the public without restriction on reuse, and further details on the package and government's response to the consultation will be published by the end of March. And I can also tell you today that in the autumn, the government will publish online an inventory of all non-personal data sets held by government and arm's-length bodies. It's a modern doomsday book for the 21st century. The programme will be managed by the National Archives. It will be overseen by a new open data board. It will report on the first edition of the new doomsday book by April next year. The government will then produce its detailed proposals, including how this work can be extended to the wider public sector. And this new book will, for the first time, allow the public to access in one place information on each set of data, including its size, source, format, content, timelines, cost, and quality. And there will be an expectation that departments will release each of these data sets or account publicly for why they are not doing so. Any business, any individual will be free to embed this public data in their own websites and to use it in creative ways within their own applications. For example, Job Centres Plus now offers a job search widget which can be put on any other website and a similar application for mobile phones. Independent developers are using the information we publish for innovative new websites and mobile phone applications, such as the latest Aspirometer, built by one person in just 5 days, finds your position using GPS and tells you how many people have been served with an ASBO in that area when it launched last month. It was number one free application in the iTunes store after a reported 80,000 downloads in 48 hours. Now, we're determined that government websites should be efficient, should meet people's needs, easy to find, easy to use, fully accessible. In our relentless drive to improve the efficiency and effectiveness of the way we use websites to meet this goal, we have already closed 900 now unnecessary government websites. We have planned to close nearly 500 more. We will set new challenging standards of quality and accountability for government websites in the future, including a requirement that each allows feedback and engagement with citizens themselves. From today, no new website will be allowed unless it fully meets these requirements. 6 years ago, we launched DirectGov. It was the first version of a joined-up view of government on the web. It now has 25 million visits a month. It offers in one place a simple portal of information for all citizens on all our public services. And by the end of May, developers will be able to use content from the DirectGov website, for example, to translate it into another language, to rearrange it so that it is more relevant for a specific local community, to alert people when it changes, or to let people create their own personal tailored view of DirectGov. But we need to go much, much further if we're to plan for the future. So our goal is to replace this first generation of e-government with a much more interactive second generation form of digital engagement, which we will be calling MyGov. Companies that use technology to interact with their users are positioning themselves for the future, and government must do so likewise. MyGov marks the end of the one-size-fits-all, man-from-the-ministry-knows-best approach to public services. MyGov will constitute a radical new model for how public services will be delivered and for how citizens engage with government. It will make interaction with government as easy as internet banking or online shopping. This open, personalized platform will allow us to deliver universal services that are also tailored to the needs of each individual. We will move from top-down monolithic websites broadcasting public service information in the hope that the people who need help will find it, to government on demand. And rather than civil servants being the sole authors and editors, we will unleash data and content to the community to turn it into applications that meet genuine needs. This does not require large-scale government IT infrastructure. The open source technology that will make it happen is freely available. All that is required is the will and the willingness of the center to give up control, and we will do so. And this bold new approach will transform the way services are delivered, but more importantly, it will be the vehicle through which citizens will come to control the services that are so important to their lives and their communities. With MyGov, citizens will be in control, choosing the content relevant to them, determining their level of engagement, and their feedback will in turn help us to improve services. With the rapid development of technology, consumers today expect so much more, but when it comes to government, they don't always seem to get it. With MyGov, they will. Today, you can book and pay for a holiday online in minutes. Why can't you do that for a blue badge for a disabled person? With MyGov, you will. You can deal with your bank when and where you want, at any time that suits you. Why can't you do that with your job center? With MyGov, you will. These days, websites tell you what other services or products might interest you. Why don't government websites do that? With MyGov, they will. But more than that, recognizing the frustration of having to provide ID in different ways to access different services, we have launched the Access to Public Services initiative to provide a shared service across government, allowing users of government services to identify themselves simply and definitively and to access those services online. Online, MyGov will give people a simple dashboard to manage their pensions, tax credits, child benefits, pay their council tax, fix their doctor's or hospital appointment, control their own treatment, apply for the schools of their choice, communicate with their children's teachers, or get a new passport or driving license, all available when and where they need it. And it's not just about gains for citizens either. Businesses can benefit too. By the end of the year, all public service contracts over £20,000 will be available on a single, free, easy-to-use online portal, and the data will be available free of charge for others to reuse. To help us realize this vision, I'm delighted that Martha Lane Fox has agreed to broaden her current role to become the UK's digital champion and help us establish in the Cabinet Office, at the heart of government, a new digital public services unit. And this unit will be charged with ensuring that departments achieve rapid progress on transferring and transforming services to online channels. It will ensure those services are designed around the needs of those who use them most. It will put the 4 million people who are among the heaviest users of government services but who have never used the internet at the heart of our strategy, rather than letting them literally slip through the digital net. Increasingly, the digital net will be the social security net, the social safety net, the only way to extend access to new, higher quality and more efficient digital services to all our citizens. Pricewaterhouse have estimated that the government can save £900 million a year just by bringing those who don't have access to the internet online so that they can carry out transactions with public services more quickly and efficiently. And we know that for every transaction with a public service that is done online rather than over the telephone, we can save around £3.30 in administrative and staffing costs. And using the internet rather than filing in paper forms or writing letters can typically save £12 each time. But the total savings would be far bigger if all public services could be accessed online. So I want the new unit under Martha Lane Fox to act as a dynamic force for change within government, helping to quickly drive significant cost savings with radically increased digital public service delivery. Now, this drive to economise must go further than the delivery of public services. For the coming second digital revolution also offers the opportunity to radically refashion government and Whitehall departments, a restructuring that means we become the most efficient, open and responsive government in the world, a reform that should allow us to make major savings on running costs while providing better services to the citizen. Traditionally, Whitehall departments have in varying proportions comprised three main elements: policy teams, including people who oversee or regulate frontline delivery agencies; secondly, a set of public-facing, often transactional services; and third, a series of back-office functions, essentially supporting the other two. The power of the new digital technology now gives us the chance to transform this model, to make Whitehall and government services more efficient and more effective. Every industry has felt the force of the internet's ability to empower consumers. Every industry has felt the force of the ability now to increase transparency. And now is our opportunity to be one of the world's leading governments addressing these challenges, to oversee an enormous shift from what many have in the past seen as a two-pound paternalistic and closed Whitehall to an open, interactive, responsive enabler where citizens personalize, shape, and then ultimately control their services. I've already set out how I believe MyGov can transform the nature and costs of the government's public-facing services. But the same is potentially true of the other two core civil service functions. Take the back office. The government is committed to achieving $4 billion of savings from back office functions by 2012-13. To drive this ambitious program forward, we intend to establish a number of business service companies. They will handle the routine back office functions of Whitehall. The prototype for this new approach is already in existence, the Shared Services Centre in the Department for Work and Pensions, which already supports 140,000 staff in three departments. It plans to take on four more in the next year. It has plans to establish its shared services as a trading fund within the next 12 months. It will explore in parallel the scope for bringing further commercial expertise into its work. Our aim and intention is that these public business services company will use modern digital platforms wherever possible and aim to be leaders in green technology and working practices. And as they demonstrate progress, there is no reason why these companies should not in time draw on private capital, giving rise to the possibility of substantial capital receipts. I believe that a similar approach can also be used to drive down the government's property costs. Significant efficiency improvements have been made over recent years. Overall costs are now £740 million a year lower in real terms than a few years ago in 2003, but operating costs can still be reduced further. We have committed to save £5 billion per year in running costs and dispose of £20 billion surplus property over the next decade. To achieve this, we will look to create a number of specialist government-held property vehicles run on commercial lines. But the impact of technology on central government should not be confined to the back office and transactional services. We have within our grasp the opportunity to harness new technology to deliver a major step forward in giving the public a greater influence over the policy-making process. Revitalizing our politics, our governance, and our democracy means going beyond simply increased openness about previously secret information. It requires the policy-making monopoly of ministers and the civil service to be challenged. Where practical, through a step change in the opportunities for people to engage and interact with government in its policy proposals. And it also means a less centralized approach to government. The Chancellor's recommendations on how to secure a further substantial transfer of civil servants out of London and the South East to other parts of the country. And I intend to build on this in the next Parliament with a further strengthening of the role of regional ministers and a streamlining and amalgamation of central government functions at the regional level. At the same time, I want to look again at whether we need so many independent Whitehall departments in this age of digital government. Most policy and delivery issues cut across the departmental boundaries, whether it's climate change, whether it's jobs, whether it's industry. Despite much innovation and experimentation with cross-cutting units, projects and public service agreements, the traditional silo-based Whitehall approach is still there but can be overcome. I've said that will be at least a 20% reduction in the senior civil service pay bill. The Chancellor will provide more details of this in the budget, and as we make these radical changes, we can also reduce the number of Whitehall departments. But as well as rethinking how the different parts of government machine can be streamlined and decentralized, we must urgently also explore practical plans for giving the public far greater influence over policy making and how it is done. The web and the internet again offers us a chance to reinvent deliberative democracy for the modern age. Digital government will help open the door to new ways of enabling people to influence and even decide big policy challenges that we face. It will give people better and more comprehensive access to the information they need to make informed choices. Ultimately, this can provide the basis for them to participate in deliberative processes to formulate policy setting in a historic shift in the way public policy is made. This includes opening more policy development to wider scrutiny, for example, through the use of e-petitions and deliberative events, Since it was established at the end of 2006, the number of e-petitions has received, the e-petition service has received more than 70,000 petitions. There have been more than 12 million signatures placed, and the government has replied with more than 8 million email responses. And each week I record a podcast, use Twitter. Number 10, gov.uk carries out daily conversations with more than 1.7 million followers. There have been almost 2 million views of our images on Flickr and 4.3 million views of our films and videos on YouTube. But we can do much more. Today we are launching a brand new Number 10 iPhone application that will bring news, video and audio from the Downing Street website to potentially millions of users, completely free of charge. So what I'm really talking about is, in essence, a new partnership to govern, an invitation for people to directly share in the task of governing that is there to serve them. And I'm today tasking every department to identify the far wider scope there is for deliberative engagement with the public, specifying the outcome expected from such engagement on the big issues. We've come a long way with the internet over recent years. When I started to use the internet first, it was simply my means of getting the football results when I was in America. And I didn't quite realize what the potential uses of it were. But with the help of ministers in this government who've been actively working on this, Jim Knight, Michael Wills, Stephen Timms, and Liam Byrne, who are here today, with the help and inspiration of Tim Berners-Lee, Nigel Shadbolt, and Martha Lane Fox, we see now how the digital revolution is creating a different world. I know that we in Britain have the spirit and the talent to take the lead in that new world. The question is whether we are bold enough to make the necessary decisions today to build Britain's digital future. My message to all of you here today is clear. We have the courage to invest in that future and to secure the growth and job it offers, not just for today, but for generations to come. We have the determination to harness the new digital technology to shake up government and drive a radical reshaping of what government does. We are focused on giving people a greater say over the policies that affect their lives and the services on which they depend. We are focused on giving entrepreneurs the chance to invest and to be part of this new revolution. We have the resolve to make sure that the immense opportunity that Britain's digital future offers are available to all and not just to some. Thank you very much for the opportunity to address you.